Sava Church.
Sava.
And welcome to Salisbury Seventh-day Adventist Church. I'm very happy to see so many visitors. After people which I've seen before, I think friends of Igor. And I'm very happy to see you back here. Even if Igor is not here, I'm glad to see you. I don't know if you know that Igor has a baby. You know that, yes? Very good. Yes, we are all happy for this blessing, major blessing in his life. Present this subject. So that's why today I brought this presentation before you, The Point of No Return. Sounds sort of tragic in some way, but we will see that this depends how we look to the situation. Can be tragic or can be happy. We will try to touch both sides of the coin, the happy ending and the unhappy and tragic ending. We are on this journey of being Christians, walking in the steps of Christ. And we are all here today because we search for something which the world cannot give us. We are here because we are searching and we want, we desire with all our heart something which only Jesus can give us, and that is the eternal life, the completeness of our soul. We want that back. We are here because we acknowledge that we are not complete, that we are in a state of lack. We lack something, and we want that something which will make us whole. If you want, is the story of the prodigal son, which Brother Charles presented to the children, small and big, today. Before we start, I would like to ask for the Lord's blessing upon His word. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, in Jesus' name we ask for your presence in our midst. Lord, give us your word. Give us the Holy Spirit, that your word may be fruitful in our minds and in our souls. Please guide us in all truth and give us understanding, as we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The point of no return. Probably in the scripture reading, which our brother John read so eloquently, you've noticed already a place of no return. Can somebody say where that was in the verses read? Revelation 22 from 10 to 15. Where is that point of no return? Yes?
I think in the verses are filthy, they have been filthy,
absolutely. Absolutely. That is, I'm going back to that just quickly. And that are actually the the Lord, Lord Jesus, is saying these words. The time is at hand. What means the time is at hand?
It's now.
Is what?
Now.
Is now, yeah? Anybody else? It's urgent. Time is at hand. Do something about it. Do something. Now. Today. And he pronounces these words. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. That's the point of no return. When God says the word, that is happening out of nothing. God's word has the power to create. He said, let there be light, and was light. And out of nothing came plants and animals and so on. We know the story of creation. When he will pronounce these words, is no return from that point. Is anywhere in Revelation another point which you can recall that is just about to be the point of no return with one of the churches? Can anyone recall that? With one of the seven churches. You probably remember Revelation 2 and 3, where are the messages to the churches. Anybody? Any idea? A thought? Anything? I'm not wrong, it's in Revelation chapter 3, verse 5, no, oh yeah, Revelation chapter 3 verse 1 is the message to Sardis, and unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, this thing says he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that you have a name that you live, but are dead. It's interesting. Going back to this. You have a name that you live, but you are dead. Sounds so bad. It's like a dead walking, isn't that right? It's like a dead man walking. And you see everybody see this person walking, but he is dead. But we will see that he's almost dead. He's not totally quenched and gone. There is still tiny little hope. But there is hope, and as long as there is still hope, life can exist. Because we see in verse 2, it says, so Revelation chapter 3 verse 2, it says, be watchful, somebody that cannot be watchful anymore. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain, that little bit which remain, that are ready to die. That things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how you have received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. And thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. While we still see some hope there, because he's almost dead, but he's not dead completely. I wonder if we see ourselves in this verse. Is this talking about who knows what, Lord? Or is this passage speaking about me? So instead of just taking a few verses of the Bible and apply them to a church somewhere in Sardis, who knows where that is, who cares? Let's take that verses and apply it to myself, to me, and every one of you, to yourself. Because it says, and God doesn't lie, that you have a name that you live that are dead. A name that you are alive, but you are dead. Almost dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain, that are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God. We know, each one of us, where we lack and where we fall short of the glory of God. Our beloved brother Bernard saying each prayer which he raises to the Lord. We have things to do. I was thinking, what shall I bring before the church which they never heard or is less little spoke about? Just to speak about the same things again and again is boring, and we start to think about what we eat after sermon, what we'll do when we get home, what is our plans for next week, and so on. So, I would like to take you through a journey. A journey in which you and me will think about ourselves as we are on this journey. Okay? So, we'll go on a journey together. You'll be part of the journey. You'll be one person in this group. And think where you are on that path. How many of you seen this picture before? One, two, three. Not many. Okay. This picture is a graphic trying to portray in this picture a dream which Ellen White had at some point. And whilst some people might think, oh, you know, it's just a dream, don't worry about dreams. I just want to remind you that I think it's Nehemiah chapter 6 verse 12, if I'm not wrong, when the Lord said, when I'll speak to one of your prophets, I'll show myself in a dream, I'll give him a vision. So let's take this dream as something which is coming from the Lord. And we will go on this path together. It's called, the vision is titled Traveling the Narrow Way. You can find this vision in the book Life Sketches by Ellen G. White. It's chapter 30. If you want to take note, it's very good. You can go search it on Ellen G. White Writings online. Many of us have it on our tablets, on our phones. Easy to find. Repeat it. Go through again at home and think about it. This is staying to my mind for years already. This picture. That's actually the profile picture on my Facebook account. Some some of you may think right now, sad. I don't care. I opened that Facebook account with a one and only purpose, to give glory to God. There's no one picture about me there. Well, that's a picture about me. Okay. I would like to read the vision, the dream for you, and to make a few emphases along the way. But instead of looking at me, look to the picture and try to visualize the movie, the film of what's going on. So, it's chapter 30, Traveling the Narrow Way in Life Sketches by Ellen G. White. And she says, while at Battle Creek in August 1868, I dreamt of being with a large body of people. Large body of people. Now, a portion of this assembly started out prepared to journey. My emphasis is on large body of people, shows in these people, and only a portion of this assembly started out prepared for the journey. We had heavily loaded wagons. As we journeyed, the road seemed to ascend. On one side of this road was a deep precipice, on the other was a high, smooth, white wall, like the hard finish upon plastered rooms. As we journeyed on, the road grew narrower and steeper. In some places, it seemed so very narrow that we concluded that we could no longer travel with the loaded wagons. With these carriages, with the horses, was too narrow to carry on like that.
So we could take our world with us.
That's one of the conclusions, of course. We then loosed them from the horses, took a portion of the luggage from the wagons and placed it upon the horses and journeyed on horseback. So they carry on like that, with some baggages on the side of the horse there. Now, I would like you to think about what that horseback means. Okay? So you are going that direction, but something or somebody else is carrying you that direction. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's the horse. It's not you going there, you just want to go there, but actually the horse is doing the job for you. You're just sitting nicely in the church. Okay, so just think about that for a minute. You are not putting that much effort into it. As we progressed, the path still continued to grow narrow. We were obliged to press close to the wall to save ourselves from falling off the narrow road down to steep precipice. As we did this, the luggage on the horses pressed against the wall and caused us to sway toward the precipice. We feared that we should fall and be dashed in pieces on the rocks. We then cut the luggage from the horses and it fell over the precipice. It's here, some luggage is falling. Not very clear with the light, but on the screen of a laptop will be very, very well visible. So we continued on horseback without that luggage. Think about what that luggage could be in your life. Greatly fearing, as we came to the narrower places in the road, that we should lose our balance and fall. At such times, a hand seemed to take the bridle and guide us over the perilous way. And I'm sure we had experienced this hand, which sometimes we like lose control, even in our spiritual life, even with our trials in our lives, and eventually like a hand just put things back in place and we carry on. As the path grew more narrow, we decided that we could no longer go with safety on horseback. And we left the horses and went on foot in single file, one following in the footsteps of another. At this point, small cords were let down from the top of the pure white wall. So let's repeat this. As the path grew more narrow, we decided that we could no longer go with safety on horseback, whatever that horse may be, which was carrying you up to there, was not safely anymore to go on the horseback. It was dangerous to go on the horseback. So because you wanted to go that way to your goal, to your target, you had to let the horse alone and go on your own feet forward. Just think about that for a moment, what that can be. I let you pull the conclusions. I'm not going to say the horseback is this or that, but who has ears can hear. So we left the horses and went on foot in single file, one following in the footsteps of another. Now I'm thinking in single file means not even husband with wife was next to each other. It was, you know what I'm saying, was individual. The experience of traveling was individual. It had nothing to do with anybody else. It was you on the path, not the group on the path. Everybody was in the file, in this single file. And at this point, when you start the journey in single file, cords were let down from the top of the pure white wall. These cords here, they started to, because it was so steep, we can see some aid coming from outside, from the top, from the heavens, to aid us in carrying on the path. This we eagerly grasped to aid us in keeping our balance upon the path. We grasped to aid us in keeping our balance upon the path. As we traveled, the cord moved along with us. Interesting. It was not like taking another cord. It was the same cord. Every person had his own cord. It was not two people holding one cord. It was not one person holding the cord and holding another person. Each person had his own, her own cord. Just let that sink in for a moment. Is my experience that I have my own cord? Am I holding? The cord moved along with us. The path finally became so narrow that we concluded that we could travel more safely without our shoes. We can see the state of comfort is just growing lower and lower. Less comfort, less comfort, less comfort. It was quite nice here at this point, no? He was just sitting nicely and the carriage was just taking, even there was quite good. He was on the horseback. But eventually you start walking, you know, it's still not bad. But now with no shoes, just imagine that. Did you walk ever on the mountain with no shoes? If you try that, that's a painful experience. It happened because my shoes was broken, and I like to climb the mountains and whatever. I like touristic paths, and I feel that beautiful fresh air in my lungs. It's just a delight. But when the shoes are broken, and you need to go back to your place of, you know, safety. That's a long journey if you have no shoes, because each step counts. It's not sand, it's sharp stones which are hurting your feet. So we slipped the shoes out of our feet and went on some distance without them. Soon it was decided that we could travel more safely without our stockings. these were removed and we journeyed on with bare feet. You can still think what that means and how it applies to myself. We then thought of those who had not accustomed themselves to privations and hardship. I found this bit essential into understanding the vision. We thought of those who had not accustomed themselves to privations and hardship. Where were such people now? They were not in the company. These people were not in the company. At every change, some were left behind. Talking about the point of no return. Some were left behind, and those only remained who had accustomed themselves to endure hardship. The privations of the way only made this more eager to press on to the end. Can you feel any discouragement there? No. He was focused on the target. 100%. Our danger of falling from the pathway increased. Can you see? It's worse and worse. As we are approaching the final destination, the spiritual journey becomes harder. If you want even more interesting, you can look from the positive point of view, you know. It's something which not many will have that experience. This is what I want to point out. Many were left behind at every stage. We pressed close to the white wall, yet could not find place for our feet fully on the path, for it was too narrow. We then suspended nearly our whole weight upon the cords, exclaiming, "We have called from above, we have called from above." The same words were uttered by all the company in the narrow pathway, from one to another. They were encouraging each other. But the experience was personal. As we heard the sounds of mirth and revelry that seemed to come from the abyss below, we shuddered. We heard the profane oath, the vulgar jest, and low, vile songs. So from somewhere there, they could hear sound of the world. We heard the war songs and the dance song. Again, something to think about. We heard the war song and the dance song. We heard instrumental music and loud laughter mingled with cursing and cries of anguish and bitter wailing, and were more anxious than ever to keep upon the narrow, difficult pathway. Much of the time we were compelled to suspend our whole weight upon the cords, which increased in size as we progressed. So sometimes we have to rely entirely on the cords. I noticed that the beautiful white wall was stained with blood. It caused a feeling of regret to see the wall thus stained. This feeling, however, lasted but for a moment, as I soon thought that it was all as it should be. Those who are following after will know that others have passed the narrow, difficult way before them, and will conclude that if others were able to pursue their onward course, they can do the same. And as the blood shall be pressed from their aching feet. They will not faint with discouragement, but seeing the blood upon the wall, they will know that others have endured the same pain. How many of you read the Great Controversy book? One, two. Three. Great Controversy book? Great Controversy? Anybody? Only three people in this audience read the Great Controversy. I would say that is really bad. All of us, as Seventh-day Adventists, we should read the Great Controversy book from cover to cover. At least one in the lifetime, but I would suggest once every year or two is the best idea. Others have endured the same pain. When you read the Great Controversy book, try not to read it like a history book, but try to read it like a history book which will be repeated. Put yourself on that path and think, what would I do in that circumstances? What would I do in that situations? How would be my response, my reaction to this trials? Would I answer the same, or would I stay low, unnoticed by nobody? So, they were not discouraged, but seeing the blood on the wall, they will know that others have endured the same pain. That was encouragement for them. At length, we came to a large chasm, at which our path ended. So, the path eventually will come to an end. There was nothing now to guide the feet, nothing upon which to rest them. Whoever read the Spirit of Prophecy and is a Bible student can fit precisely this sentence in the prophecy. So we'll come at some point, this situation, that nothing will be upon which to rest them. So kind of like that. Our whole reliance must be upon the corpse, which had increased in size until they were as large as our bodies. I stayed and I think, what that means? And came to my mind that that must be, the faith is connecting us to heaven. If you have any other idea, any other thoughts, you can correct me. I'll bring your input. But I think it's about faith. That is the cord which holds us connected to heaven and carries us through the faith. And that faith increased in size until they were as large as our body. So the faith became as big as us, filled us up really. And popped to my mind this text in Revelation, I think 17:12, if I'm not wrong, about the faith of Jesus. Not the faith in Jesus, but they keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. The faith of Jesus is in them. The faith of Jesus is that fullness which you grasp and you don't let go. It's a point of no return. You are not letting go. Who remembers Jacob and his night battle? He said, I won't let you go until you bless me. That man was decided, now or never. I said, I'm dying here, but I'm not letting go. Did we reach that experience? Is it about us? Let's think of that for a moment. Because we will come to that point. Here we were for a time thrown into perplexity and distress. We inquired in fearful whispers, to what is the cord attached? My husband was just before me. Large drops of sweat were falling from his brow. The veins on, in his neck and temples were increased to double their usual size, and suppressed, agonizing groans came from his lips. The sweat was dropping from his face, and I felt such anguish as I had never felt before. A fearful struggle was before us. Should we fail here, all the difficulties of our journey had been experienced for nothing. Should we fail here, all the difficulties of our journey had been experienced for nothing. We can see that somewhere, surely not now, but somewhere in the future, maybe in the near future, we'll experience something similar to these words. Agonizing groans. Large drop of sweat falling from the ground. I felt such anguish as I have never felt before. A fearful struggle was before us. But should we fail here, all the difficulties of our journey had been experienced for nothing. You know what that means? Are there people which are coming to church every Sabbath, which will experience all their life trials for nothing if they let go when the hardship will be almost impossible to bear? Almost. Before us, on the other side of the chasm, was a beautiful field of green grass, and it was about 6 inches high. I could not see the sun, but bright, soft beams of light, resembling fine gold and silver, were resting upon this field. Nothing I had seen upon earth could compare in beauty and glory with this field. But could we succeed in reaching it? Was the anxious inquiry. Should the cord break, we must perish. Somewhere there. Will be a point in our Christian experience, in our spiritual journey, when there will be nothing and nobody to hold us but the faith we have in Jesus. That will be a point in which we can't afford to let go. Should I said the cord is our faith in Jesus, but more than that, is the faith of Jesus in us, became from the faith in Jesus, became the faith of Jesus. You see what I'm saying? And that will keep us to go through. Should the cord break, we must perish. Will our faith break? Again, in whispered anguish, the words were breathed. What holds the cord? For a moment, we hesitated to venture. Then we exclaimed, our only hope is to trust wholly to the cord. It has been our dependence all the difficult way. It will not fail us now. Still we were hesitating and distressed. The words were then spoken. God holds the cord. We need not fear. These words were repeated by those behind us, accompanied with, He will not fail us now. He has brought us thus far in safety. And we see here how important it is to recall how the Lord carried us through the whole journey till where we are now, and where we moved on to that point where we are then, and so on, to carry on and carry on and carry on thinking. I remember a passage in Ellen G. White writings where she says, it's no more danger, no bigger danger for the people of God that the danger that they forget how the Lord carried them till there. Can you recall that passage, yeah? We need always to remember how God carried us through till now. Here we are, still alive, no matter what we're going through, and so on will be till the end. My husband then swung himself over the fearful abyss into the beautiful field beyond. I immediately followed, and oh, what a sense of relief and gratitude to God we felt. I heard voices raised in triumphant praise to God. I was happy, perfectly happy. And this is the end of the vision. That was the dream, that was the vision which she received through the dream. And I believe it has a very powerful and strong application to our own spiritual journey. That words are there for our encouragement, that we may not let go, that we may not let go, no matter what. Brothers and sisters, where are we on this journey? The time is at hand. Think about these words. Think about these words like you never thought before. What if today these words are spoken in heaven? He, put your name and replace the he. Who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. He who is holy, let him be holy still. Obviously, we can be in one of the two camps. Or unjust and filthy, or righteous and holy. But our faith will decide where on this camp we are. On the right or on the left. Think about ourselves, not think about anybody else or anything else. Think about you, about your life, what you are doing, what to be Adventist means. What the fact that you are here means. Where you will go after leaving the church, after hearing these words. What you will do with what you heard today. How next week is going to be affected by what you heard today. Behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his words. Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. These are the blessed ones. But outside are the dogs, the sorcerers, sexually immoral, and murderers, and idolaters, and whoever loves and practices a lie. That little sin, which we call it little, lie. It might be deadly. I'll take the lie away. It is deadly. It's not about talking a lie, it's about living a lie. Being somebody for the Sabbath and somebody else for the rest of the week. Or just for a tiny little bit during the week. We know, each one of us know what that means. With this in mind, brothers and sisters, let's think about me and you. Some 500 years ago, on the 31st of October, 1517, Martin Luther, which was a Catholic monk, decided to change the course of his life, and he just couldn't let go. No matter the pressure, no matter the anguish, no matter the circumstances. He said, here I stand, I can no other. May God help me. Will this be our words when the time of that pressure will come our way? Because it will come. Of course, no one will be given more than is able to carry. But if that comes to you, that means you've been entrusted that situation, because God trusts you that you can go through, through His power. In His power, you can go through. That's why He allowed you to reach in that point, in that circumstances, in that situation, which you find to be overwhelming. Just think about that journey. Martin Luther started the Protestant Reformation, and great light came to the world through his action of rebelling against the Mother Church and exposing its abominations, the Catholic Church. Ellen White says, oh, by the way, I asked you about the great controversy. I wonder if I should ask you, who read The Last Day Events? One. Any other people? Last Day Events. It's a book we should be in every home, Adventist home. And it should be read again and again. Last Day Events is something which we all should know what's written in this book. Anyway, from this book, it's a compilation, it's the best compilation ever on these Last Day Events. And it says how the Roman Church can clear herself from the charge of idolatry we cannot see. And this is the religion which Protestants are beginning to look upon with so much favor, and which will eventually united with Protestantism. This union will not, however, be affected by a change in Catholicism, for Rome never changes. She claims infallibility. It is Protestantism that will change. The adoption of liberal ideas on its part will bring it where it can clasp the hand of Catholicism. Another one from Last Day Events. When Protestantism shall stretch her hand across the Gulf to grasp the hand of the Roman power, when she shall reach over the abyss to clasp hands with spiritualism, when under the influence of this threefold union, our country, America, shall repudiate every principle of its constitution as a Protestant and a Republican government, and shall make provision for the propagation of papal falsehoods and delusions, then we may know that the time has come for the marvelous working of Satan, and that the end is near. Actually, last week I seen an article exactly on this topic, and believe it or not, was representatives from the major Protestant churches, together with the Catholics, and together with Orthodox representative, which was, guess what, speaking in tongues, praying in tongues together, so bubbling, all that. It's scary, all these things which when I first read them and heard them, I never believed would happen, or at least not in my lifetime. Now in 20 years after, I see them happening, and it's just overwhelming. These things are true. Let's not forget the history. That is the biggest danger. To end this presentation, I want to pull your attention to the current events, to the prophecy being fulfilled, to the ecumenical gatherings which are happening, and some of you are aware of, some of you don't know anything of, but you should. Because Jesus Christ said, watch, watch, watch. To watch means not to sleep, means to be attentive, pay attention to details, to what's happening. Actually, this prophecy, which was written over 100 years ago, come to life right now, when the leading churches of the United States, uniting upon such point of doctrine as are held by them in common, shall influence the state to enforce their decrees and to sustain their institutions, then Protestant America will have formed an image of the Roman hierarchy, and the infliction of civil penalties upon dissenters will inevitably result. That is from Great Controversy, page 445, paragraph 1. Brothers and sisters, how am I preparing for what is coming? How are you preparing? Are you ready? Who am I in Ellen G. White's vision? Where is my point of no return? Is there anything I need to change after hearing this message, to do different than I've done till today? Am I still climbing? Am I still moving forward? I call you to experience true repentance, confession of your sin. Experience the forgiveness, because He is faithful. If we confess our sins, He is faithful to forgive. And to receive that peace which surpasses all understanding. This is what we are here for. We want that peace, that we are in peace with God through Christ. This is a call to reconsecrate your life individually, not in group, not in families if you want, but personally, me. What am I doing with my salvation? Reconsecration and reform of life. We know where we are stumbling, where we fall short, where we are doing wrong. We know too well when we should do this. Don't postpone it. Don't leave it for next week. Don't leave it for next month, for next year, for a convenient time. Do it today. You've heard the message. I believe the Holy Spirit impressed my heart and your heart. And we have things to do as we leave today, this place. Maybe we will have to choose between that TV and the Bible. There are still Seventh-day Adventists which are spending their hours in front of television each day, when the Bible don't have that attention from them and the Spirit of prophecy. What about being useful in the work? It's so convenient to come every Sabbath, come and go, sit, listen, serve, go, and nothing changes. Week after week, month after month, maybe even a year after year. What is our progress? Where is our place in work? What are we practically doing for the Lord? Apart from when we are requested to do a prayer or do a reading or sing a song or whatever. I promise you, is space, is room for everyone in work. And all of us, we have a big job to do. Don't think, oh, I have no talents. The talents are there. I appeal to you to follow Jesus Christ till the end, no matter the cost. Now, if any of you, impressed by the Holy Spirit, would like to know more, to understand better, I ask you to please contact me or Hilda and ask for Bible studies. feel you want to get established in the truth. You want to prepare for baptism. Don't delay. Don't delay. We need to trust Jesus for the remissions of our sins. We are not one day safe without leaving that record clean behind. If the record is not clean, we cannot go forward. We cannot progress. We need to make this commitment to Jesus and to never go back. We need to make that point of no return real in our lives. If you want a visit, you want to speak one-to-one with somebody, please let us know. We can and we will visit you. And we can speak no matter what bothers you. Clarify the things which you have unclear. Don't just leave them week after week. Thinking of baptism, you are not sure. Come to a conclusion. Have faith. And finally, if any of you needs a prayer, needs the church or the church board to pray for a special situation in your life, of course regarding to the faith, ideally, let us know. We will have a board meeting together with a prayer meeting next Sunday. So now is the right time to give us a bit of paper with what we should pray for. No need to even to write the name if it's a situation which you prefer not to write the name. We can understand that. Of course, if you put the name, we will pray more specific. Give us that paper. Make a commitment. Do something. Don't leave today this place, remaining the same person. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.